English department, and she is going to have a fascinating presentation today about Black mermaids diving into the deep. Quick logistical thing, if you haven't already, please go see Sarah to check into Eagle Engage for those of you who are students. If you are here to get extra credit for a course, or if you get wings points or trio points, then see me back there at the little reference shelf at the end of the presentation. Sound good? Any questions? Wonderful. Without any further ado, Dr. Joyce White.
Thank you very much.
Okay, let me try this. Let me see if I can actually get the microphone on and then we can get started. Can folks hear me over in Statesboro? Hopefully. Okay. Well, okay. We're going to go with yes right now. So I'm so excited today to talk about a course that I'm teaching, and I've been teaching for about a semester now. This is my second semester teaching it. And also an area, excuse me, I'm getting over a cold, so forgive me. Also an area that I've begun researching a lot more, and it's really tied to some of the scholarly work that I've done previously, but has become a new focal area for me, and one that I'm just so excited to dive into. Forgive any water puns that I make. They just roll off the tongue. They're going to happen. So go with me. But really, I'm just really excited to talk to you today about this. And it's just always such a pleasure to be able to teach a course like Black Mermaids. And I know you have lots of questions. And probably one of them is, what is a Black Mermaid? And we'll get to that. But I wanted to talk first about how this course came to be, how I conceptualized it, and why a course like this is important, and also why should Black mermaids be taught in an institution like Georgia Southern. And actually, I forgot to say all my thank yous at the beginning, so I'll start with those. I thank the library specifically for inviting me and thinking that my class and my research area is interesting enough to connect with. And I thank you all for being here to listen to this. I also have another thank you, and that is Dr. Kendra Parker, who is a colleague of mine in the Department of English. And really, if I talk about how this course came to be, I have to give her a shout out and a thank you. So Kendra, when you do watch this, she's at another event, couldn't make it here today. When you do watch this, thank you. I'm fairly new to Georgia Southern. This is really my second full year. And Dr. Parker and I have this thing that we do at the end of the semester where we kind of like just debrief. She always asks, you know, how did the semester go? What did you teach? What did you like? What did you learn? What are you going to do? And it's a time for me to reflect and then to also think forward about what I'm going to do in the next semester. And so there's this course called, you know, 2100, ENGL 2100. Some of you might have taken it if you're students here or are considering taking it soon. And it's a course that deals, it's humanities and literature, that's the title, but that faculty can personalize and really talk about whatever kind of thematic, you know, topic they want to. And so while I was happy doing the pursuit of happiness, which I had done for two semesters, I was looking for a change. It was something that had run its course. And, you know, I talked about the Dalai Lama to Desmond Tutu to, you know, the Declaration of Independence, and it was a wonderful course. But I was looking for something else. I was looking for something that really connected to what I do personally as a scholar and a researcher. And so in one of these debriefing sessions, Dr. Parker says, you know, oh, did you, we're talking about the live action 2023 Little Mermaid, you know, trailer that had just come out. And she's, you know, we've been talking about nature and water because that's really tied to the things that I do as a scholar. And, you know, I just taught a course in African-American literature, a graduate course, and every book, it wasn't my intention, but every book had something to do with water, whether it was a hurricane or a flood or just gorgeous bodies of water. And so I was thinking, yeah, I think I'm going to do 2100, something to do with nature, something to do with water. And then, you know, Kendra comes out of the blue and says, Black mermaids. And I said, Black mermaids? And she said, Black mermaids. And I said, Black mermaids. And we just went back and forth for a couple of minutes talking about Black mermaids. She said, you're going to teach a course in Black mermaids. I said, am I going to teach a course in Black mermaids? I don't think so. I'm not teaching a course in Black mermaids. She said, no, you're going to teach it. I was like, I don't know about this. So all of this is over a conversation, but I talk about How I conceived of this, because a lot of times our scholarly pursuits start there. There are ideas, or we're trying to figure out where to move or how to move forward, and sometimes it just comes really organically out of a conversation, which it did. And so out of that came not just a wonderful course that I love to teach, but also a new area of research that I'm very excited about tackling. So I talk about that. There are other things, though, that occurred that really cemented the fact that I needed to teach this course. So I talked about the live action 2023, Little Mermaid that was coming out. And the trailer that came out had a really intense response. There were really two veins of thought. Either people loved it, loved the idea, or hated it. And what was really at the center of the love and hate that it was getting in terms of the response from people was that the Ariel, the main character, was going to be played by Haley Bailey, a Black woman. So people who loved it found joy and found it refreshing and found it a wonderful thing. I mean, she has a beautiful voice, by the way. I mean, if you want to talk about somebody who reimagined those songs, watch that film, right? But there were other ugly comments, very, very, very vile comments about how a Black woman really shouldn't be at the, not just the center of the story, but at the center of a mermaid story. And so it really did give me kind of the fire underneath me, right? Not only just propose a course like this, but I'm going to go forward with a course like this, and I'm going to research it, and I'm going to let y'all know why Haley Bailey should, not Halle Berry, because I do it all the time, but hi, Haley Bailey should and could play a Little Mermaid. So out of that, oh, okay. Nope. Uh-oh. I did. I did. One minute as we pause for technical difficulties. That's right. You're all anticipating the next slide. Okay, all right. So out of this sort of debate, really, it's not a debate, but this intense sort of response that people were having to the Little Mermaid, really vile and racist ideas and comments were coming up. I mean, it was so intense, the response to the Little Mermaid, that they had to disable the like and dislike buttons in the comment section. That's how overwhelmingly people were responding to this. Out of this comes you can see it, completely racist and just vile ideas about the Little Mermaid and commentary about this Black woman playing a mermaid. And so this is from, it's a now defunct Facebook page called Make America White Again. And you can see the image of, supposedly Ariel positioned on a watermelon with a drumstick in her bosom. And the facial, I mean, it's not even human. Like, it doesn't even really look like a depiction of a human. Also, a meme from the guide from Geek Moms is, also responding, like, why are we policing this? Why are these Karens out here? This is the image of the Karen, right? Why are these Karens out here underwater in scuba gear at that, on the phone, policing this Black woman who, or the idea of a Black woman playing this role of Ariel? By the way, the first Little Mermaid that everybody was, who was having this sort of, really vile response to the new live action was a cartoon, and a Disney cartoon at that. So I wasn't really quite sure, what to do with all this, but I knew that I had to move forward. The other things, there were claims that people were making about why this Black woman should not play the Little Mermaid. And first is that the Little Mermaid is a Danish story and therefore Ariel should be white. Also, mermaids live under the sea, therefore they would not have dark skin. I don't know if they've ever seen a manatee before, or a dolphin, or a shark. But anyway, I digress. Mermaids are European mythological figures, and therefore Ariel should be white. And then lastly, making Ariel black is ruining childhood. This is my favorite one. Is ruining childhood and changing the character. I don't know whose childhood is ruined by the Little Mermaid, but apparently it's ruining childhoods out here, and changing the character. All of this to say, what's really at the root, right, is that the idea and really the sort of supposition, the claim that a Black woman cannot be a mermaid. And when we think about that, and what I always, kind of challenge my students to think about from the beginning of this course throughout is, why not? What is it that people are saying when they say that a Black woman should not play a mermaid? And what is it really, even more importantly, that they're erasing when they say that a Black woman shouldn't play a mermaid? Because mermaids, in particular, Black mermaids, have existed for 5,000 to 6,000 years. So I don't know, the Danish story, 1800s, 5,000 to 6,000 years. What are we talking about here? And so what really is at the core of all of this are the ideas that we have around beauty, the ideas that we have around who has the right to tell a story or whose story is right. But one thing that I know, and one thing that, none of this really takes into account, is wherever there is water, there are mermaids. There is mermaid lore, right? So every culture has a right to that story. Every culture has those stories. And I decided to tell this particular story through this course. I'm sure you guys have seen the Starbucks siren many a day. Do I have the Starbucks siren? But most of us don't know the mermaid on, what is this, on my right side. Let me get the right arm. And this is Yimmy Ya. This actually predates the Starbucks siren. And if you really look at the images, the iconography, it's exactly the same. But we don't know this story, right? But we know this one. We know this brand. It's recognizable world round. I mean, I was in, different countries that have Starbucks, and you see the branding all the time. But people don't know this story. And yet we want to conflate the idea. We want to dismantle it into this one-dimensional type of story, that only one kind of mermaid can exist, or that only one culture has the right to have a mermaid, or that only one culture tells the story of a mermaid, or that only mermaids exist in this one sort of, very small box, in this very sort of stereotypical way. When, again, all these stories have been here. It's just a matter, again, of not just representation, because representation matters, but telling history, like understanding history, understanding culture, understanding that, there are other stories to be told. So for the second half of this, I want to talk about Black mermaids, because I know that's why you're here, to talk about Black mermaids, or maybe it's just for extra credit. I don't know. I don't judge. But, I want to talk about what Black mermaids are. And please keep me on time, because I am talkative. So the first thing I want to say is that Black mermaids are not a response to white mermaids, right? Or the idea of a European mermaid. It's not a response. There's so much more to this. And to just really categorize it as a response to something is just really invalid. Black mermaids are ancient. They are based in spirituality. They are something that exists in terms of merfolk around the world, but also an encompassing idea of the water and then what's in the water and what's reflected by the water. They are orishas, or deities, if you like that word better, that are understood by observing the forces of nature that they rule over. And today we're going to talk about water orishas, which are the mermaids, right? And they are emissaries of Olodumare, a god Omari. So they are sent into to deal with humanity through their forces of nature. So humans understand their nature, right, through nature itself. So human nature is exposed. This is a great quote by Joan, Joan Morgan, who talks about one water orisha that I'll highlight today, which is Oshun. And she says that Of all the tools Oshun is said to carry, perhaps the most powerful one is her mirror. And we know that mermaids, one of their things that they carry, combs, brushes, mirrors, right? That's one of the most important things. She says that to a layperson, a layperson might mistake this for a sign of her vanity, right? Mirrors, we look in the mirror all the time, right? Those of us who know her a bit more intimately, however, recognize the mirror as a tool of Oshun. That she holds up to our faces when she requires us to do the difficult work of really seeing ourselves. So as the water is reflective, right, this idea of the mirror being reflective, it forces us, the nature, right, that she represents, that Oshun represents, forces us in order to see ourselves, to see our own humanity, and to see what that humanity is doing, maybe in the right way or not doing in the wrong way, to reflect and to be insightful about who we are. And aren't these, isn't this just a gorgeous picture, by the way? This is some artwork that I took a picture of from an exhibit I'll talk about a little bit later on Black Mermaids. So I'm going to talk today, just for the rest of the time, about four water orishas. And when I talk about orishas, I talk about deities. These are not conflated to the whole continent of Africa. I am talking about West African and particularly Yoruba, the Yoruba pantheon of orishas. And one of the reasons why the Yoruba pantheon of orishas are so popular and most people know these names is because when we talk about enslavement, which is the dispersal, right, that happens, the major dispersal of Black folks around the world, 50% of those people came from Yoruba countries, right, that practice Yoruba religion. So they are particularly popular around the world still to today. The first is Yemiya, and you'll see in parentheses many other names, and these are representative of the places that Black folks ended up landing. Landing is a nice word. Ended up going as a result of the Middle Passage and enslavement, and different places have different names from the Caribbean, like to Cuba, Yemiya, Yemoya, Yemiya. There's lots of different spellings. It's all Yemiya. That's what it boils down to. But Yemiya is the mother of the sea and the ocean. That is her designation. And we'll talk about her a little bit further. Oshun is the mother of rivers and streams. So again, another mother of water, but of particular bodies of water, right? Mothers of rivers and streams. Mamiwata, who has a lot of names, and we'll talk about why she has so many names, and she's represented in so many different places. And my favorite is Crocodile Person. I think Mami Muntu is my favorite of hers. She is also considered mother of the water. You can see Mamiwata, a sort of pigeon name for mother of the water. And then lastly, Olokun, who is often called the keeper of secrets because Olokun is often androgynous, but also the Orisha of the deep sea. So Yemiya is the top half of the sea. Olokun is the bottom of the sea, that unknowable, uncharted part of the water that we don't go to. I'm going to get into each of these a little bit more. So Yemiya is known of as the mother of all. She is the mother of all orishas. She is the mother of all of humanity. She's the mother. She's just the mama, okay? She is the one, the big mama, who is really known for the maternity in all of our lives. Her name really boils down to mother whose children are fish because of the uncountable nature of her children, because she is mother of everything. Part of Yemiya's mythology is that she gave water to the earth. So that was her job. So from the water, right, if we think about the sea and the idea of us starting in water, you know, even from an evolutionary standpoint, right, that Yemiya is really the mother of everything then, right? Because she you know, gives it all to it. She's often seen as, or the sea is often seen as amniotic fluid. So the womb, it's representative of the womb and of giving birth to all life. And she also also it's an area or a place where we think about transformation and rebirth, that things are able to give birth to, things are able to evolve, things are able to then transform. And one thing that I love about this picture and why I put it up here is that she often dresses herself in seven skirts, so seven white skirts with the rim of blue. That's representative of the ocean itself, the profound power of the waves, right? Cresting, dancing. If you see people who are initiates of Yemiya, they always wear white. They always wear very full white skirts with blue on the inside to mimic the ocean in the waves. So Yemiya is over all of humanity, over all of the Orishas. She is particularly interested in fishermen. They go to her for protection. She's particularly interested in children and in mothers, right? So maternity and pregnancy. So giving life. She's also a mermaid, a black mermaid. Olokun, and I went a little bit out of order, but that's all right. Olokun is known as the Orisha of the deep. And this is a proverb that relates to Olokun, that no one knows what lies at the bottom of the sea. And the reason I put Olokun after Yemiya is because they make up the entire ocean, right? Together. They're often seen as twins or as husband and wife. Sometimes they're conflated to one thing. They'll just say Yemiya and mean the whole thing and, kind of add Olokun into that. But I love Olokun. Olokun is androgynous and can be male or female, or just, not known, right? And so Olokun means a lot of different things and represents a lot of different things. Olokun is a world within a world. So if you think about the bottom of the ocean and what it represents, it's dark. If you've ever seen pictures of like the fish that we can actually get to and see, sometimes they're fluorescent, they glow in the dark. Sometimes they're flat, they are skeletal. There are all sorts of things that are down there that I just could not have imagined ever and probably didn't want to imagine ever. So it is a world within a world. The bottom of the ocean also regulates the world's climate. So we ought to take care of our climate. Sometimes when there are storms, like really deep rumbling of storms, they are saying Olokun is pretty mad at humanity for not taking care of nature, right? Olokun is also, or the bottom of the sea, is representative of the land of the dead, where mythical monsters are born. So these sea creatures that come out of the sea kind of live with Olokun and maybe of his creation. While Yemiya is protective of her mothers and of pregnancy and children of maternity, Olokun is the giver to children to barren women. So those who wouldn't have been able to give birth or haven't been able to give birth would go to Olokun to receive sort of the powers to do it. And he lives in a palace, or she lives in a palace with mer people, which I love, which is part of Olokun's mythology. Also called the keeper of secrets, because what's at the bottom of the sea, we don't know. And what goes down there, we don't know. And the deep is the spiritual waiting room where the spirits of the dead can be reborn. And this is particularly important, and you'll see this when I get to the significance of water. When we talk about water in African-American literature and African-American context, and just for the African diaspora as a whole. His colors are blue, dark blue and white, very similar to Yemiya, and they have the same numbers, number seven, like seven seas. He also has nine. I'm not sure why, don't ask, but that is one of his numbers, or her numbers. Oshun, and I'm going to show you a pop culture reference to this in a little bit that my students are always fascinated by, and I love to talk about too. But Oshun is sweet waters, the brooks, streams, rivers. She embodies love and fertility. Oshun is said to be very beautiful. She loves champagne and perfume. She's very wealthy, like she loves the high life. She's always in gold. Her color is yellow or gold. And she is most often approached with money matters. Obviously, she likes the high life. She's got, you know, a little bit a change. So she is also, she's representative of high life. She is the youngest Orisha and said to be either Yemiya's daughter or her sister, her younger sister. It depends on her mythology. But she also remains and retains the title of Great Queen. Part of Oshun's mythology as a mer person, as a mermaid, is that she was charged with actually putting humanity on the earth. Like she actually, Yemiya gives the water, you know, kind of the life force for all of humanity. Oshun is the one that actually puts humanity on the earth. And it goes like this. There are 17 Orishas, 16 are men, and it's Oshun. The 16 men and their task with, you know, birthing humanity. The 16 men say, Oshun, girl, we don't need you. Like, you know, you just stay up here. We're going to go down here. We got this. They started mansplaining and, you know, all the things happen. They go down and nothing happens. They can't create anything. So they have to come back to Oludamare and say, hey, listen, we really tried, but it was a no-go. Like we weren't able to create humanity. And Oludamare asked what is called the Oshun question. He says, where were the women? Did you contact them? Were they involved in this? And they had to say no. And so they had to go back and beg Oshun to come down. And so she actually by herself creates humanity. So she is credited for birthing humanity, which is why she has the title of Great Queen. She heals with her sweet waters, but just as sweet as she is with, you know, sweet waters and lovely brooks, she can be as sour as well. So both, all of these Orishas have a duality of beautiful peacefulness and, you know, the serenity of water, but that water can also get you. That water can drown you, or it can be a storm, right? That can get you. Her colors are gold. Her number is 5. Peacock feathers are one of her things. She's often seen with a mirror, like the quote that Joan Morgan talks about. But, you know, again, very beautiful, always seen as very beautiful. Often seen as vain, but you can see here, when you think a little bit deeper about what these people or what these Orishas represent, it really is more about human nature and looking within ourselves and finding our own nature than it is about just a simple mirror. You know, it's like what I tell my students, you can read here if you want to. That's fine and good. But when you really read, then you find out the good stuff. The last Orisha that I'll talk about, the last mermaid, love mommy water so much. She's also called the mother of water. Sometimes she is conflated with Yemiya. Sometimes people confuse her with Yemiya. We'll talk about that in a second. But like the other Orishas, she's found in coastal waters, ravines, lake areas. She began in traditional divinity in West Africa and beyond, actually. But then these were elaborated in the 15th century. What's happening in the 15th century on the continent of Africa? Enslavement, right? Yeah. The Europeans, particularly the Portuguese, come. They've been trading for a little bit, and then the slave trade starts to occur. For some reason, Mami Wata, because she is so dispersed everywhere, begins to pick up lore in other places where Africans are being shipped to, right? And so she evolves all over the place, from Suriname to Brazil to Trinidad to Jamaica to even Zaire, who call her the crocodile person. That's where that name actually comes from. She's all over the continent of Africa, and she is all over the world, really. And so that's why she's rooted in traditional divinity, but she's expanded. She even takes on the form sometimes of a Hindu goddess, Lakshmi. So sometimes she looks that way. So it's quite interesting the way that she's evolved. She can create natural disasters sometimes if you anger her or not doing the right thing, or she can be consulted for a lot of human concerns. And some of those are very much, you know, situated in modernity, And that were introduced by things like colonialism and post-colonialism. So she really found, I think, some staying power. Not that Yemaya or Oshun or Olokun haven't found staying power, but for some reason she traveled quite a long way and has reserved a lot of a staying power in a different way. She's always seen with a snake, always. See, you know, a black mermaid with a snake, this is going to be Mami Wana, always. Sometimes her colors are blue and silver. She's often seen with red and white, though, which is a reflection of her volatile nature. So she can be as calm and peaceful as, you know, the sea and blue and water. She can be as fierce as the color red, though, too, when she's angered. So really, really interesting. Arisha, to me, I just love her. So when we talk about this idea then of Black mermaids and how they've traveled and they've come across, we also have to talk about the significance of water, and like what water means and how it's rooted in this same sort of history and spirituality. And I just wanted to highlight a quote. How many of you guys have heard about the Igbo landing? All right, we got a couple. Okay. Well, the Igbo landing right down the road, Dunbar Sound, happened when enslaved people were brought in and then ferried on small boats going onto an island. And they saw the land, they could see it. They were chained together, men, women, and children. And I'm short circuiting this, but you'll get it. You know, they saw the land and they understood what was going to happen, which was enslavement, right? And they refused and resisted it and would not go on the land. And so they walked into the water. Now some, you know, a lot of folklore comes out of this. Some people said they flew back to Africa. Some people said they walked on the water back to Africa. And some people said that they swam back to Africa. But the power of the story, what they said as this occurred, whether they flew back, they swam back, or they walked back, is that the water spirits brought us here and they will also take us home. And so the significance of the water and the water spirits really kind of go hand in hand when you talk about Black mermaids and you talk about these Orishas. Because what happens on the water, this Atlantic water that we talk about, that reverberates, that has really a call and response between the Americas and the continent of Africa, is that we have a site of both memory and history. And it's just fascinating to me that even before the 2023 live action, that African-American authors, Black authors have been writing about these sites and about these Black mermaids long before, you know, Haley Bailey was cast in, you know, this 2023 remake of The Little Mermaid. And part of what happens there is that the water then holds within it memory and it holds within it history, and it becomes the site that can be revisited and transformed. And what happens on those sites can be rebirth. People are in those waters. People thrown overboard that were living people that might have passed away, that have transitioned. And particularly what seems to be the focal point are pregnant women who were thrown overboard. Because what the literature asks is, what happened to the children? When these women gave birth in the water, did the children transform? And what if they did? What if they did transform into mermaids? What would happen then? And so we have beautiful bodies of literature that really ask these questions and challenge us to kind of rethink history and go back to these sites of trauma. Then the water itself becomes a ground of remembrance, as it should, right? And it also becomes a ground of remembering. So putting back together a trauma, but also a forgotten past. Because if you're talking again about how people responded to this idea of a Black woman playing a mermaid, then we need to go back and remember some things. We need to go back and think about what water holds, which is this collective memory, this idea of this, you know, these beings, this culture that came across the water water and rebirthed itself on land, right? That these Orishas came with them, and some say traveled with them, protected them on the way. That these sites then become places of transformation and rebirth, and that we have a call and response, an ancestral call and response between the continent of Africa and the people of Africa that are dispersed around the world. And that this literature and a class like this is a symbolic return. It returns the remembrance, it returns sort of the reverence, it returns to another site or story, it widens our understanding of the world, it gives us more dimension, it gives us an idea of how people lived, what they believed, right? How they persevered, how they survived, what is considered one of the most horrific times in history. And it gives us then for these people and these bones who are now with Olokun in the deep, right? It gives a language to the ancestors who are there and ought to be remembered, ought to be given reverence for their lives. And so the water is just as important, right? The nature then becomes just as important as the symbol of that water, which are these Black mermaids that I talked about. Just to give you a little, I know I'm probably over, but I'm gonna go really fast. Just to give you just some reference of some of the research that I've been doing to really bring into not only the classroom, but to then do some scholarly work of my own. The city, let me say that, it's not silly, sorry. The City Gallery, in Charleston, South Carolina, in the summer, I think that was May or June, had an exhibition called Black Mermaids. And this is just two pictures. I mean, extraordinary exhibit. You can see some of the pictures online. And I think they're going to do it again in Buford next month, in March, yes, if anybody is interested in that. But I went there and just had such a wonderful time, and you know, was just draped in all this loveliness. This is a picture of Yemi Ya, or a rendition, and this is of Mami Wata, and you can see this is like the whole span of the upstairs all the way down to the downstairs. It was absolutely gorgeous. I also got the opportunity to go to the Smithsonian Museum of African Art. And they had an exhibition by Yana Jackson called From the Deep. And she did all of this artwork and all these installations from the novel The Deep, which I actually teach in class, by Rivers Solomon, which is a collaborative piece. And then it just kind of keeps expanding. People keep doing things with it. And so it was really fascinating to be able to go and see all this wonderful art. I just wanted to show you a couple of pictures of where Black mermaids have been showing up for quite a long time. Again, you know, before this 2023, I don't know where people have been, you know, before this 2023 live remake. We know who this is, yes. Dressed up as Oshun. This is almost exact as the picture I showed you of Oshun. Beyonce also calls herself Oshun sometimes and also calls herself a mermaid. She's definitely made a reference. She thought she was a mermaid in a past life. I play it for my students all the time. I'm like, can you believe it? And you know, she has this whole like, you know, scene by the water. I'm just mesmerized by it all. So it shows up in pop culture. Actually, one of her first videos with Destiny Child, she's a mermaid. She's in a fishbowl it has nothing to do with the song, but you know, I'm here for it. It's definitely, yeah, she's an icon. I'm here for it. If Beyonce wants to do it, I'm here for it. I'm here for it every day. These are three of the novels that I teach in the course. And I teach folk tales and all other sorts of small pieces. Skin of the Sea, which our library has. I'm looking at all y'all. The Deep, which our library has. And A Song Below Water, which our library, I hope, will get. So three wonderful novels that have Black mermaids at its core, right? They are the main characters. Really, A Song Below Water is a siren, but okay, we won't get technical there. Also, two films that I think are wonderful. Daughter of the Sea is a short film that was just, it did fantastic at Sundance, and it was just released to watch. It was at a bunch of film festivals, but now it's just been released by Venmo and or Vimeo, whatever that site is. Y'all get what I'm saying. And it's a wonderful, it's 18 minutes, but it's so, we just finished watching it and talk about it in class, and everybody was mesmerized by it. It was just absolutely beautiful and sensational, and features Yemi Ya. And Nanny, which is a film that's on, I think it's on Amazon. I think it's an Amazon film. Yes, it is. And which we also watched, which is about the Senegalese woman who immigrates to America and has all these encounters with Mami Wata. It's great. I wasn't going to watch it because I thought it was really scary. I thought it was a horror film, and I don't do that. But it ended up being fantastic and beautiful. So I think that's all. I hope you guys enjoyed this talk about Black Mermaids, and I guess I'll take any questions that you might have or comments.
I think Dr. Parker is Black
Vampire. Yes. Yes, yes, it is. It is. She's fantastic. Yeah. Oh, yes, 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 yes. Okay, for online, this wonderful person says she took Dr. Parker's Black Vampire class and she thinks it's wonderful, and if you have the chance, take it. And I agree. Any other questions?
Yeah. Not a question so much a statement. I'm struck by the similarity amongst Native American communities out in the Great Lakes. There's a tradition there of looking at the beach, and I imagine that most people aren't aware of that. Like something that, in general, they have one conception of mermaids.
Yeah.
Star, how people get upset about that. They got so upset that for black hobbits.
Oh gosh. Yes. You've gone too far with that. Hold on, mister. So let me see if I can recap that for those of you on Zoom. The comment was that Native Americans in the Great Lakes also have lore of more mer people in the deep, and so it's yes, sort of a universal thing that ought to be highlighted. And also the comment kind of talked about how people had this kind of response to Black Hobbits. Not a talking tree or walking tree, but Black Hobbits, you know, because, you know, God forbid there be a Black Hobbit. I don't know what that's going to do to the world. No other questions? No comments? Oh, hi.
Also, that for a long time, wrongfully, Black women have been like seen as not feminine.
Yes.
That mermaids are just simply so very feminine or sex symbol.
Yes.
So definitely Black women. Like,
yeah.
You can't fathom that, you know.
Yes. Yes. So the question is whether or not some of this has to do with Black women maybe not being seen as feminine, wrongly so, obviously. And my answer to that is absolutely. If you think about mermaids and the lore of mermaids and what they kind of represent, it has a lot to do with beauty standards, right? And so I, you know, in the class, we often, that's where we start. We actually start with beauty standards. We start with our own biases. We look at the way in which we view the world and the way in which we see things and how we get information and how we process information and how that actually has an impact on our own lives, our barriers, our impediments in those ways. And part of it is exactly that, like how, and I think that was the issue with part of the issue with Halle Berry is a lot of people were like, well, what about Ariel's long flowing red hair? So these standards of beauty, right? These ideas of what a mermaid can and can't be and how a mermaid looks. And it's just so one-dimensional and ridiculous, right? Because I just showed you, you know, four very powerful warrior-like, women who are mermaid in form.
So you think the exhibition for the Black Mermaids will be in Beaufort?
next month?
Yes. The question was, do I think, is the Black Mermaid exhibition, it's by Cookie Washington. She is the coordinator of it. And I think, yeah, it's at, I think it's the University of South Carolina's Museum at Beaufort. Yeah, I'm pretty sure. So the question, I'm sorry, I'm trying to talk and answer at the same time. I'm terrible at this. But the question was, the exhibition happening in March, and it is at, I believe it's the University of South Carolina at Beaufort. I'm pretty sure that's where it was. I have it open on my tab, my page right now, so I don't forget, because I haven't put it in my calendar just yet. Yes. If not, it's out of the window.
If you'd like, I can try to send that information to folks who checked in. So.
Yes. So that information will be sent to folks that checked out. Okay. Well, there's nothing. Oh, no. Okay. I'm here for it. I'll take whoever. So the question was, when we think about different mythologies and sort of different iterations of that, I'm shorthanding your question. Are these mermaids that I talked about today often shown with like fish tails? And if you think back to the picture I showed you with the Starbucks siren and Yimmy-Ya is always shown, not always, but often shown with holding two fish tails. So is Olokun. Mamiwata is sometimes shown with like as a full on mermaid. Sometimes she's not. The same with Oshun. Sometimes she's shown as a mermaid and sometimes not. It really just kind of depends, but they're always talked about as a mer person in their mythology and in ancient texts. Yeah.
Curious for your class, are students doing projects, how are they engaged in?
Yeah, good question. So the question was, students in my class, are they doing projects, papers, like how do they engage with the material? So there's a variety of things they do. Right now they're working on an essay, probably much to their chagrin, but that's fine. They do an essay. We are doing a tweet from the deep. So we're doing something with different characters out of the novels, actually responding to the controversy of The Little Mermaid. So that'll happen at the end. So if any of my students are here, we haven't talked about that yet. And then they also are doing sort of an infographic sort of representation of the deep, going through chapters thematically. So there's a lot of different projects that they do. We do a lot of class discussion and thinking critically, really through, we just did that with films where we kind of break the film apart, thinking about it from the director's point of view, from the character's point of view, from the audience point of view. So they kind of get how the film was made and get a deeper understanding of all the elements that actually go into it. So a variety of different things, trying to engage the material as much as possible. We started off with folk tales and read those and talked about that in class. So yeah, a lot of discussion, a lot of fun projects. And I don't know that they're having fun right now writing the essay, but they will in the end. It'll be a wonderful experience. That's what I tell them. Thank you.
From a statement, but it's actually a French drag queen named Mamiwata that she has two teeth, and she named herself after the goddess.
Yeah. So the comment was that there's actually a French drag queen that is called Mamiwata with two T's, which sometimes you'll see that spelling as well. But there are a lot of people who name themselves, like even one of the artworks that I showed with kind of the colorful, it was right before I went into the original, like the colorful kind of, I don't even know what you would call it, like a boa and lace. And so her name, the artist's name is Yimmy-Ya. So there's a lot of people who do take on these names of the Orishas as well. But yeah. Yes?
I think you mentioned this earlier, but uh-huh. Some of your other research also relates to water.
Sure. I published a book in, oh Lord, what is this year? 2024. I'm here. at the end of 2020. We'll say that at the end of 2022, the years are starting to merge together in front of my very eyes. But anyway, and it was based on the novelist Edwige Jandakot, and a lot of her novels really talk about the relationship of people on one side of the water to the other. But it's also an indication of whether people have passed on as well. So they live on, you know, either the physical side or the spiritual side. So I talked a lot about ecology and water's representation in her novels, nature in general, specifically, and how she uses that as a way to really talk about the major issues, and also using orishas as well within the novel to represent an occurrence or something that's happening to the character or a way to kind of move the plot forward. So I hope that kind of answers it a little bit. Sorry, the question was about my research in the use of water. Sorry for the people online. Okay.
We have time for about one more question.
Okay.
Favorite folktale from this genre that you can summarize?
Do I have a favorite folktale is the question from the genre. Yes. There is a Haitian folktale, which I actually used in that book, called Mother of the Water. And it is about this young girl. It's kind of a Cinderella story, actually. So this young girl who, in some iterations of the story, her father has died, and this is her stepmother and stepsister. And some iterations, she's just a poor girl that has to work for this family. Well, anyway, she's down in the river washing the silverware, and she loses a spoon. And she knows she can't go back until she finds the spoon. And so out of the blue, this woman who has like barnacles on her skin, just looks really gnarly, says, "Will you help me wash my back?" And the little girl says, "Yes, I'll help you wash your back." So the old woman takes her back to the house, feeds her because she's malnourished and treats her well, and tells her the next day, "I'll give you the spoon back if you follow my directions." And so she has these bunches of tasks that she does, and she follows all the directions. And so the next day she said, "I'll give you riches on your way back home, but you must only, they're eggs, and you must only pick up the eggs that don't speak to you. The other eggs are going to say, pick me, pick me, pick me. But don't pick those, pick the eggs that don't speak to you." And there's another thing with a cat that she's not supposed to feed, but she feeds. But anyway, she passed all the tests. And she gets all of the silver and all of the silverware, right, to bring back. So she goes back and she's, you know, wealthy now. She's got a little bit of change. And the stepmom tells the stepsister, "Now you go to the river and you go and try to get it." So the woman appears again, and you can guess what happened. The stepsister doesn't follow the steps, you know, doesn't do the right thing. And I think she's eaten in the end, or like something really bad happens to her. Like she disappears, like, and she gets no riches, obviously. So, yeah. Moral of the story, behave and be good, right? And good things will come to you. Well, thank you guys so much. I appreciate it.
Okay, well.
Thank you.
All right. So folks who are on Zoom, if you need a Wings credit or any kind of other like credit type of information, please add your in the chat, your email address, your Georgia Southern email address, and also the organization for which you're trying to earn points. If you are here in person looking for Wings, Trio, or extra credit with the professor, then back there, Sabrina, can you wave? Right back there. We will help you sign in. For the rest of the time, we'll have refreshments out here until 6 is when catering is going to come and clean them up. So feel free to continue to use the space, converse, hang out. But thank you all again for coming and participating. Thank you again to Dr. White. Let's give her another round of applause.
Great.
And we hope to see you again next semester. Thanks so much.